In this video, we'll discuss two topics associated with fluid dynamics, that is to say, a fluid that is flowing. The first topic is the continuity of fluid flow, which involves the term flow rate. And the second topic is Bernoulli's equation. As we discuss fluid dynamics, we'll make three assumptions about the fluid. We'll assume that it is incompressible, which means that the fluid won't change volume significantly when compressed as it flows. Usually, we can consider a liquid to be incompressible, but we will also approximate that gases are incompressible in some situations. In addition to being incompressible, we will also only deal with fluids that are considered non-viscous. You can think of viscosity as the thickness of a fluid. We'll consider water to be non-viscous, but something like honey would be considered viscous. And the third assumption is that the fluid flow is smooth and non-turbulent, which is referred to as laminar flow. All right, so let's get to it. We'll start by defining the term flow rate. Flow rate indicates how much fluid flows through a cross-sectional area per time, usually volume per time, such as gallons per minute. Where we use a Q to represent flow rate, and V is the volume of the fluid that passes through a cross-sectional area in some amount of time. The SI units are cubic meters per second. There's another useful way to calculate flow rate, which I'll derive. Let's start with a visual of a volume of fluid flowing through a pipe at speed V. This is the volume of the fluid, and this is the cross-sectional area of the pipe. The volume can then be calculated by the area times the length of the fluid, which I'll call delta X. Now let's start the derivation with the original equation for flow rate and replace the volume with area times delta X. So the equation is now A times delta X divided by time. Written this way, we can see that delta X divided by delta T is average speed. So now the equation can be written as area times average speed. This is the alternate equation for calculating flow rate, and I'll add it next to the original equation. Be careful not to mix up the V's in this equation. Capital V is volume, and lowercase v is speed. The new equation is an instructive way to write flow rate because it clearly indicates how flow rate depends on the cross-sectional area and the speed of the fluid, which I think makes sense. Consider water flowing through a pipe. If the size or cross-sectional area of the pipe is increased, then clearly more fluid will flow through the pipe per second. Or if the pipe is the original size, but now the speed of the fluid is increased, then we can clearly see that more fluid will flow through the pipe per second. Now that we've defined flow rate, let's discuss the continuity of fluid flow, specifically for an incompressible fluid, but this is already one of the assumptions anyway. Again, let's think about a fluid flowing through a pipe. Say there are 4 gallons of water flowing into this pipe every minute. Then there better be 4 gallons of water flowing out of the pipe every minute as well, because if more water flows into the pipe every minute than flows out, it would build up in the pipe, and this can't happen if the fluid is incompressible. Or if more water flows out of the pipe every minute than flows in, then where would the extra water be coming from? It would mean that the water is being created in the pipe somehow, which of course isn't happening. So another way to say this is that the flow rate into the pipe equals the flow rate out of the pipe. And we can say this generically for any two sections of the pipe, even if the pipe has different cross-sectional areas like this. So the flow rate in section 1 here equals the flow rate in section 2 here. This statement is the continuity of fluid flow, which you might write as Q1 equals Q2. But it's common to replace each Q with area times speed. So this is how we typically write the equation and apply it. Notice that while I describe this principle using a pipe, it actually refers to any continuous stream that doesn't split into multiple branches. An important consequence of the continuity of fluid flow is that the fluid flows faster when the cross-sectional area is smaller. This is what happens when you put your thumb over the end of the hose, covering part of the opening. The area is reduced, so the water sprays out with a greater velocity, as shown in this video. Now let's discuss the second topic, Bernoulli's equation. Bernoulli's equation is derived from the conservation of energy involving the kinetic energy and gravitational potential energy of the fluid and work done to the fluid by the pressure differential in the fluid. To derive this equation, consider a fluid flowing in this pipe, which has a change in diameter and a change in height. Now consider a volume of fluid that moves from location 1 here to location 2 here. At location 1, the fluid is at an average height of y1 and has a cross-sectional area of a1. And at location 2, it is at an average height of y2 and has a cross-sectional area of a2. Now let's apply the conservation of energy to this volume of fluid as it travels from location 1 to location 2. Where the initial location is location 1 and the final location is location 2, so I'll change the initial and final subscripts in the equation to 1s and 2s. Now let's consider the net or total work in the equation. The work on the fluid is caused by the pressure differential on the fluid as it moves. In location 1, pressure differential is here, and it does positive work because it is directed in the same direction that the fluid is moving. In location 2, the pressure differential is here, and it does negative work because it is directed in the opposite direction from the direction that the fluid is moving. The total or net work, then, is work 1 minus work 2. And we can then put this into the equation and organize the variables so that all of the location 1 variables are on one side and all of the location 2 variables are on the other side of the equation, like this. Further, we can recognize that each work term is force times distance, where distance is the distance over which the pressure differential is calculated, which is the width of each fluid segment here. Also, the force can be written in terms of pressure. Pressure is force divided by area, so we can replace the force in the work equation with pressure times area. And so the work equation becomes pressure times area times distance. And one last modification to the work term, the volume of each fluid segment is area times distance, so we can replace AD with volume. So now we can see that work equals pressure times volume, and we can make that substitution in the conservation of energy equation. At the same time, I'll replace each kinetic energy term with 1/2 mv² and each potential energy term with mgy. After making all of those substitutions, the conservation of energy equation now becomes this, where I have given pressure, velocity, and height y a subscript corresponding to the location of the fluid segment. But the volume and mass of the fluid segment in each location is the same, so I didn't put subscripts on those variables. The next modification I'll make to the conservation of energy equation is to divide the entire equation by the volume. In the work terms, the volume cancels out and we're left with just pressure. And in the kinetic and potential energy terms, we have mass divided by volume, which is density. So making those changes, the equation finally becomes this. This is Bernoulli's equation, which I'll rewrite here. We will apply Bernoulli's equation to several different applications, but there's a special case that is interesting and useful. It will also be an instructive example of how to apply Bernoulli's equation. I'll wrap up this video by discussing this special case. The special case is when there is a change in the cross-sectional area from location 1 to location 2, but there's no change in height. An example of this is a fluid flowing through a horizontal tube shaped like this. Let's consider region 1, where the tube has a large cross-sectional area, and region 2, where it has a small cross-section. If we apply Bernoulli's equation, we can subtract out the potential energy terms, rho gy, because the heights are the same in these two locations. So the equation simplifies to this. Now let's consider what the continuity of fluid flow equation says about this scenario. As described by the equation, the fluid speed will increase in section 2, where the cross-sectional area is smaller. So we can apply that fact to Bernoulli's equation. As a result of this, we see that the pressure in region 2 must decrease. This result gives us a very useful principle, that fluid pressure will decrease if the fluid speed increases, assuming that there's no significant change in fluid height. This principle is not necessarily intuitive, but it has some important applications. One such application is to provide lift on an airplane wing. Consider this cross-section of an airplane wing. As air flows over and under the wing, because of the shape of the wing, the air travels faster over the top of the wing and so tends to travel faster. This produces a lower pressure on the top of the wing than on the bottom. This pressure differential helps to lift the wing. I'll add that this is not the only factor or even the dominant factor that produces lift on the airplane wing, but it's part of the effect. Another situation when a drop in pressure like this is important is in a blood vessel. Consider blood flowing through a blood vessel. Normally, the pressure inside the blood vessel is equal to the pressure outside the vessel. But if there is partial blockage in the blood vessel, then the blood will flow faster through the constricted area, per our discussion on continuity of fluid flow, and this will drop the pressure in that region. Because of this lower pressure, the blood vessel may be crushed by the greater pressure outside the vessel. So these are just two examples of what is referred to as the Bernoulli effect, where pressure is lower in faster-moving fluid. But there are many other interesting and important cases where we can see this effect. Anyway, that's it for this video. Please be sure to review the posted worked-out examples on fluid dynamics as well.